This is a Blaring Out with Eric Blair show, and today I'm here at punk legend Carl Roessler studio. We thank you for allowing us to come into your humble abode here.
Yeah, this is my studio. This is Kitten Robot Studios.
You are a man that wears a lot of different hats in the music business.
Musician. I do music.
Yeah.
Yeah. Help other people make music as well.
And we saw your beautiful blue Persian cat, which is the most amazing thing I've ever seen in my life.
Peanut. Yeah. He's getting internet famous.
Oh, is he?
Yeah, well, he gave you a little, like, kiss, right?
Yeah.
He's not super friendly to strangers. Some people are really scared of him, but he's a sweetheart.
We're going to talk about your relationship with Darby Crash. So tell me how you met Darby and how that evolved into being friends with Pat.
First time I saw him, he was walking across the field. This was probably 1975, and there was a whole crowd of people behind him, and he had blue hair. And I was I'd never seen anybody with blue hair. This was before punk rock had started. And I remember seeing him around. He really stood out from everybody. There was something really clearly different about him. And I asked people, who is that guy? And people warned me, don't talk to him. He'll brainwash you. So already, you know, 16 years old, people were sort of afraid of him. And he was, you know, really involved in, I guess, psychology of some sort. Psychology. He was reading a lot of philosophy and a lot of mysticism. I know he was... read everything he could read about Manson, and he done a lot of looked into Scientology a lot. So he was kind of using the kids in high school as guinea pigs for this stuff he was sort of interested in. So as soon as I was told that I shouldn't hang around with him, that he was dangerous, I had to become friends with him. And that wasn't that easy because his mode was more make fun of you until you've sort of broken into his circle. So it took a little while. We were in a special school within a school there that was based on EST, do you know, Earhart Seminar mm-hmm. Training? It was mm-hmm. sort of a 70s, but it was really really interesting stuff, different, totally different approach to education. And we were in that school together. And we became really good friends. I think Pat and he were like best friends, and Pat was away at religious school that year. So Pat, Darby and I became really, really close. And then that's kind of how I got into punk rock, because they started a band. I had already was one of those nerds in the music room guys. I'd been taking classical lessons for, you know, at that point, 10 years already, and practicing 8 hours a day. I say 8 hours a day. It was actually 10 hours a day, but that sounds like I'm exaggerating. So when they started a band, Pat and Paul, it was George and Paul at the time, it was really insulting to someone like me who had been working so hard to master classical music and jazz and progressive rock. I'd already written a 47-minute prog piece. But I think that was part of the fun of it. So then I went and saw them play, and I saw them play with the Deadbeats at the Whiskey. And it was, you know, I basically, rock music had become so terrible by 1977 that I was quitting to be a classical piano player. And I saw them, and I saw that the Deadbeats were this incredible musicianship, Zappa-esque sort of punk band. And then the Germs were, you know, Antonin Artaud, Theater of Cruelty shit, you know? The thing about the Germs was, I just figured this out later, the spaces in between the songs were as important as the songs. You know, they were one of the few bands where they would play a song and then there'd be a 5 or 10 minute break while stuff happened. You know, the fights would break out and someone, Darby's trying to score drugs and someone else was making out in the corner. It was like the whole scene became part of the show, and that was really illuminating. And then later, you know, Darby died, and that was really, really sad. I think he was a genius who'd had a really, really difficult childhood and had was driven by demons and really was filled with so much pain. He really didn't plan on living a long time, and he thought, since he didn't really want to be alive, how could he, you know, use that? I think originally, I mean, his intelligence was, I saw his you know, he had 40 IQ points more than I did. And so I think first he wanted to be sort of like a fascist. First he wanted to start a large religious movement. He wanted to be an L. Ron Hubbard or Buddha. And then I think he got impatient with that, and he was interested in being like a sort of a fascist dictator, and then he saw that that was probably never going to happen, and so he got this plan of what he was going to do with the germs. But at the time, I don't think he was, I mean, not all people knew what he was up to, but he was pretty much, I know the Screamers had seen some of his, read some of his lyrics, and had, we did a cover of one of his songs. They spotted his intelligence, and, you know, he's a pretty unique person. I mean, I've known a lot of people, and he was kind of one of a kind. I think the punk movement in 77, 78, what you had was a bunch of super intelligent, creative people that by the sort of aligning of the culture shift, they were in the right place at the right time. They all came together in one place. And I think they were people that were really, really dedicated and devoted to put their entire lives into this sort of moment of time and art and expressing a sort of a new voice in art. So, you know, glamour is another word for magic. And it's magic is when our ability to describe things with science breaks down, it looks like magic to us. There was a really intense magic, for want of a better word, or science. It was a really intense energy at that time. And I don't mean energy like in a, like astrology talk. I mean, when you had John Denny and Tommy Gear and Tomato Duplenty and KK and Pat Smear and Darby and Exene and John Doe and, you know, Leonard and the Dickies and Scott Guerin from the Deadbeats. I mean, Greg Ginn was in the audience all the time, you know, and, you know, Mike Watt and Dee Boone were driving up from San Pedro to be in the audience. And my sister Kira was there. You had such a collection of personalities. Now, these are the people I knew, and they're my friends, people I've been friends with forever. So I don't know if they are different from pockets of people everywhere. But that glamorizing in film and in the storytelling and the fact that there was these 7 inches, in a way it's unglamorized because it never went through the mainstream, you know, media. So it's sort of, it was prevented from becoming, I think I'm using the word glamorized the way you mean it. It didn't really become glamorized, so it's more mythic, maybe. Like, I don't know if the story of Jackson Brown and the Eagles is mythic. I mean, maybe it is to some people, and Joni Mitchell. To some people it is. It's mythic. But there's something, considering how small it was at the time, there's something really mythic about that era.
I asked a girl the other day as I was walking through the aisle, band, do you like the band or do you like the shirt? She goes, I just like the shirt. Never listen to the band.
Well, that's cool. Design and symbolism is very powerful. And, you know, that kid came up with the blue circle in the black field, you know? And this thing is that symbol is iconic. And the bars from Black Flag, which you see everywhere, you know, that guy went on to become a very famous artist. Ray Pettibone was a person who was there too. He's like hanging in museums all over the world. So it was a pretty cool little scene there, wasn't it? And if it's reduced down to symbols, I mean, that's interesting too.
I think even though the people that are wearing the shirts don't really understand the true meaning behind what that band stood for, that it's still okay because it's in the realm of art.
Is it okay? It just speaks to the sort of vision of the people that were there in the beginning, you know? And they were set free from, they were sort of in the shackles of this previous culture that had died out, you know, the hippies. And they were really set free by sort of a combination of Malcolm McLaren, Vivian Westwood, and Johnny Rotten, you know? The three of those got together and created this thing that just blew people's minds open, I think. I mean, maybe that's a simplification, but I think Malcolm McLaren had a situationalist background and he was sort of understood the anarchist art movements, and Vivian was able to do it with fashion, and she became, I mean, you just keep
iconic.
You keep listing the names of these people.
Yeah.
You know.
No, they're all icons now. They're all important. I mean, Vivian Westwood is equally as important as Coco Chanel.
And you get groups of people like that together all in one year, and they're all reacting against something that had happened before, that had, and that had sort of gotten really stale, And so they just, there's this explosion of creativity. And it never really became mainstream, really. So it's that's one of the reasons that a model can still wear that Germs t-shirt, because it doesn't immediately evoke an era, or, you know, it doesn't evoke lameness. Mm-hmm. It's still cool. I mean, she has a certain coolness that she's wearing a Germ shirt, yeah. You know? Good for her. Silke Berlin. Silke's like she's got an incredible voice. I mean, she's got like she has like Axl Rose range. So she did a duet with Jack of old Adam and the Ants song, and Rick played guitar and bass, and Don's been playing drums. And then she did a duet with Rick of We're Desperate, and she did one with Sammy from Fang of Jackson, the Johnny Cash song, and June Carter. And then we just did a version of Happiness is a Warm Gun, which to me, it's like, why would you cover that song? It can't be improved upon. Mm-hmm. But it came out really cool. She did one duet with Rick of We're Desperate, and Rick was singing. And I'm listening, and I go, who does he sound like? His voice sounds so familiar, like some singer I've heard before. And I realize, oh my God, he sounds just like D. Boone. Now, I don't know if anybody's thought of this, and I don't know if I should be pointing this out, but D. Boone's dead. That's great that there's someone who sings like D. Boone. So he's singing We're Desperate, and I'm like, it's like a duet with D. Boone and Silke Berlin. She's been doing a series of duets. She did one with Don of a Ramones song, I Just Want Something to Do, where he was singing. Don's fun to work with, too. I remember doing a show where 45 Grave played with Christian Death. And I think that's the only time I ever saw Christian Death. And I remember thinking, wow, these guys are really good, you know? But whenever I had a show with 45 Grave, it was like, there are so many notes I had to remember, you know? So I was mostly concentrating. And I was playing in five other bands at the same time. So I was mostly... And 45 Grey, there was this added thing. Besides remembering all those notes, I also had to, like, do this makeup and all this stuff.
I know you're a huge fan of the Google car that is coming our way.
Oh, for me, no more accidents, no more speeding tickets, no more time driving around looking for parking, you know, no more having to go to the mechanic to get my car fixed, less money on gas because they're more efficient. I can be making my phone calls while I'm driving and texting. I don't have to be, you know, paying attention to where I'm going. For a lot of people, it should be, you know, no need to have a job anymore. No more taxi drivers, no more bus drivers, no more delivery people. All those people get to have all that time off to do whatever they want and live a life of leisure. That's the promise of technology, a life of leisure for all of us working stiffs. I'm kind of thinking that with the antidepressants, everybody's like got an agenda about it, but I think human beings are like find themselves in a really uncomfortable environment right now, and there's sort of a evolution and a metamorphosis coming. I even don't even know if you could really call us Homo sapiens at this point, because we are so technologically dependent or symbiotic. We're so technologically symbiotic. We're almost a different species. We don't hunt our food. We buy it at the store. You know, we're connected to history and information all out through out the world at all times by the phone in our pocket. So that's an uncomfortable. And there's a lot of probably a lot of toxins in the environment. So it doesn't surprise me that people would start cropping up with a lot of emotional reactions to that, whether it be depression or anxiety or stress. And, you know, maybe that's a cop-out, but it doesn't surprise me that there might need to be some sort of pharmaceutical aid to just dealing with an environment like this, conceivably. So, you know, I'm not down on the people, because look, you know, anxiety and depression sucks, and you can't wish it away, and no. You can't think it away.
No.
You know, you can't think away. If you got it, you got it. And if you've gone to therapy and you've tried quitting drugs and you've gone through hospital, you still got it. I am, and by the way, you know, sure, pharmaceutical companies have a financial interest in getting everybody on them. But, you know, it's not a science giving people that stuff. It's still an art form. There's still like, they don't go, oh, you're depressed, here, take this. There's still a lot of play where they have to sort of, you know, so I mean, it'd be great if nobody had to do that, but I could see, you know, with the nature of the stress and the, you know, there's a lot of hostility and stuff. And man, I mean, if it takes people like some sort of something to call, chill them, I mean, I think it's better than, maybe better than someone who drinks alcohol constantly. I mean, you don't, I mean, there's anecdotal evidence of people killing themselves and killing people on antidepressants, but there's like daily evidence of people going out and drinking and killing each other. I don't really worry about Big Brother at all. Big Brother is people. Big Brother is people. Big Brother is people trying to sell you things and trying to get you to just, you know, conform to society. And, you know, individuality and freedom, these are these things that we hold so dear and we treasure so much. But if we're really evolving into, like what I was thinking this week is that I think we're just about reaching the point where we're no longer the dominant species on the planet. The internet is now the dominant species of the planet, and we are just appendages of the internet. So if you're going towards a hive mind anyway, you know, privacy, this idea of fiercely protecting your privacy, do you notice that people don't even really care about it that much?
It's ironic that Andy Warhol said in the future everybody will have 15 minutes of fame, except it went over 15 minutes, yeah. Way over.
And it's fame to like, okay, you're not going to have fame to like a billion people, but you can have fame to 20 people. It's really like our scene in the punk rock scene. You know, there was really only, we were famous in our own minds to 120 other people that were at the Mask, you know, and none of us could, I mean, and now it's at least like 125. I mean, we didn't know there'd be like five more people over those 35 years would find out about it. So I just think there's a lot of like assumptions in when we think about these things, we have assumptions. The assumptions are, if human beings really evolve, a lot of these things about like privacy seemed like the most important thing to us 20 or 30 years ago. It seemed so important. And now it seems like less important. And you know, stuff like Google cars and technological advances, like money seems so important, but if like things are free more and more, it'll seem less important. You know, things will just shift. Well, actually, we trade with the banks and the governments. They do stuff for us that we like, that we can't do without, that we want so much, and then we get to complain about them. But you know, we all want to drive on those roads. We all want an internet. We all want a cell phone. We all want a nice studio. We all want a girlfriend. We want a cool haircut. And we want to wear black. I mean, you know, really, seriously.
Yeah.
The people that want to bomb everything back to the Stone Age and start over, those people worry me. I'd much rather get along. And as far as thinking that there's some guy somewhere, they just want me to pay them. You know what I do is I don't buy anything. What I've found is I buy enough to eat. I try not to throw anything away. I want to drive as little as possible. I really don't want to fly anymore. I don't eat meat. I don't drink. I don't do drugs. And I just don't buy clothes. What I find is people give me and throw away more stuff than I can possibly use. I'm kind of weaned from that consumer's tit. I really kind of am. It's easy. It feels really natural. I've stopped wanting things so much. You know, enjoy sleeping, enjoy talking, you know, I like talk to hundreds of people all the time, like just, you know, and I think people are getting smarter and smarter and they're evolving and everybody else wants to howl. People are getting stupider. I'm like, no, they're not. Everybody thinks it's getting more and more violent in the world. No, it's not. It's not getting more and more violent. I don't think it's getting more and more violent. There are studies that say it's not getting more and more violent. We see more violence. But I've heard, you know, in primitive tribes, they've done studies of primitive tribes now, because that's our only indication of really how violent we were in hunter-gatherer times. And they go, you know, the possibility of being killed by another human being in some tribes was as high as 60% in your lifetime. And in the lowest cases, it was like 15%. You know, 15% chance that you were going to be murdered or die in war. In the 20th century, in our culture, it's like less than 1%. So, you know, I think people are getting tame and, you know, we're becoming more and more domesticated. I just think that's kind of an inevitable thing. But I could be totally wrong. This is just kind of my observation. I know there's all this horrible stuff going on in the world. We don't know how much we're controlled. You know, we don't. I think we are controlled contingent upon how much we want stuff. Because the people in our culture, they just want us to be good, obey, and buy, and work, and buy, so that money keeps getting. Money is the motivation, you know. I believe in our culture.
How fulfilled are you as a person?
I'm pretty fulfilled.
You wake up with a smile on your face?
Oh, I wouldn't say that. No, I'm. I have to work to get a smile on my face. I think I operate somewhat from a deficit. I think that I did drugs for years and years, which changed my brain's chemistry, which made me, and also I was in very long-term difficult relationships. I raised two kids in poverty with drug addiction around me at all times. And I saw a lot of my dreams sort of slip away from me of what I wanted. So I had a lot of disappointments and a lot of suffering. I watched both my kids be drug addicts and then recover from that. So I've had, and that yet right now my life is, you know, wonderful. The problem is what we do is every time we get what we want and what makes us happy, because we've been, this is my theory, mm-hmm. because we've been taught since we were 1 year old from watching cartoons, you need to buy this so you'll be happy. We forget about everything we have and we think about the one thing we don't have. So I have to constantly, you know, I'm still susceptible to that. I'm susceptible to like, what is the one thing that's not perfect in my life and I'm gonna obsess about that and make myself unhappy about that. And so I know people, my father wakes up and seems to jump out of bed happy, but he also hates everyone and feels the world is going to hell and wishes, you know, a lot of people were dead and has like an arsenal of guns. So jumping out of bed happy isn't necessarily the answer. You know, how fulfilled was the original question, mm-hmm. am I? I'll tell you, when I was 16, I mentioned earlier, I wrote a piece, a 47-minute prog piece. And, you know, punk rock happened, and that piece went into history for 35 years. And 2 years ago, I got this recording studio and I recorded it. And it was like, you know, for 35 years I walked around with, I put 2 years into composing this piece and it's unknown and it's forgotten. And to pull it out, to record the whole thing and to see like, oh, I wasn't crazy. I really worked really hard and did something really beautiful as a young man. And I got to like bring it to fruition. So I had this incredible fulfillment from that. Now, it was printed up on vinyl and went up for sale. Nobody cared about it. You know, nobody just said, wow, Paul, you're right. You really are the shit, you know? So there's this constant like, you know, tendency. But I'm like now to the point where that stuff makes me smile a little bit. But, you know, it's like, you know, and what if everybody would have heard that song and like I'm conducting it at the Disney Hall this week? Would I suddenly be more fulfilled? I would be fulfilled in the work. I would be fulfilled in the work. The recognition of it is it's just a crapshoot that I've sort of, like the materialism and the consumerism, recognition and fame for the work we do, it's much more, it's like a funny thing to do work that's to be playing in a pizza parlor, and playing the most beautiful music in the world, and have everybody talking and eating their pizza and like spilling their Cokes on their kids. Now it fills me with joy and makes me laugh because I'm a little bit of a cynical bastard, you know? But I'm pretty fulfilled. Look at this place.
All right, Paul Roessler, thank you for being on the Blairing Out with Eric Blair Show.
Always a pleasure with you, Matt, my friend. You ask good questions.
Thanks.